This morning in John 11 is where we're coming from, John 11, and we're beginning in verse 1. And a lot of times you don't bring your Bibles to the campground, but if you got a smartphone, you got a Bible in it, we encourage you to get it out because we want you to read with us, especially this morning. We do have quite I really like to stay in the scriptures and preach, use the scriptures. And today where we're at, it's a story that you're probably very familiar with, but I want you to hear it directly from the Bible, then we'll share some thoughts from that. And what we've been doing now since January 2016, we started a new series. We actually started this ministry in June of 2015, but in January of 2016, we began a series of looking at just the words of Jesus, looking at his life, started with he was a boy at 12, and chronologically we've been going through his life at the words that he says to us, and we are in our 92nd message on the words of Jesus as we going through this. And I pray that it's a blessing to you, and I think today will be, because it's a very familiar story. In John 11, in verse 1, it says, "Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sisters sent to him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.' When Jesus heard that, he said, 'This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it.' Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Mary and Lazarus. So when he heard he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after that, he said to his disciples, 'Let us go to Judea again.' And the disciples said to him, 'Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you.'" We saw that last week. "And you are going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day?" Now this is a good lesson right here within itself. If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not on him. These things he said after that he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up." Then a disciple said, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well." However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he was speaking about taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him." Then Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us go that we may die with him." So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Mary and Martha, and to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatsoever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is come into the world." And when she had said these things, she went her way and secretly called Mary, her sister, saying, "The teacher has come and is calling for you." And as soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the town, but was in the place where Martha met him. Then the Jews who were with her in the house and comforting her, when they saw that Mary arose quickly and went out, followed her, saying, "She is going to the tomb to weep there." Then when Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Therefore, when Jesus saw her weeping, the Jews who came with her weeping, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind also have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and the stone laid against it. And Jesus says, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there is a stench, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was laying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that you may believe that you sent me. That they may believe that you sent me. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth! And he who was dead came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with cloth. Jesus said to them, loose him, let him go. Now, actually, I know death is the last thing any of us like to talk about, right? We don't like to talk about death because it makes us feel uncomfortable. It's awkward to talk about death because we are unable within ourselves to conquer death. Even with all the medical experience and all the technology we have today, we cannot conquer death. But in John 11, where we just read, John gives us an account of a man who was raised from the dead. This is the seventh miracle that John recorded for us that Jesus did. It's the third time that Jesus has raised someone from the dead, but this is the longest this person has been dead that he has raised from the dead. So when you read of Jesus raising these from the dead, I know people always ask the question, why are they not being raised today? Why are the dead not being raised today? And he actually answered the question in the scripture we just read, and I'll go back to that with you in just a moment. But I want to ask you a question. In reality, I mean, really think about it. I know most of us have been around somebody that was dying, they had cancer or heart problems, and they've been sick for a while, and they're weak and they're frail. In reality, if you had the opportunity or the power, would you really bring the people you love that is now resting with the Lord back to this earth? Would you really want to after they've been resting with the Lord? You know, I was challenged one time. A man came into the church on a Wednesday night, and he stood up in the middle of the church and challenged me and said, have you ever raised the dead? There's a pastor down, he says, in Africa that's raising the dead. And he was trying to promote this person. And I know personally I've never raised the dead, but my Lord has, and we have witnessed it many times when people who are dead in trespasses and sin, who are captured by sin in this world, come for the Lord and they are set free. They are made alive. I said, that's the greatest coming alive there is. It's when you come alive in the Lord, when that which is dead comes alive. But we know here he is talking of the body death. And I used to use, or I have used, and probably still will use the analogy of Jesus weeping here, because this is a very tender picture of Jesus he walked up to them and he was talking. It says he groaned. And I know if you've been around death, again, you have that emptiness, that groaning, that hurt within sometimes you can't explain. And it said he did that. And then later it said he wept with them. He cried with them. And then he groaned again within himself. But I like to use that analogy to show the tenderness, the love that Jesus has for people. But as I was reading this again and thinking about this particular message today, I got thinking, was he really groaning for those of the family? Or was it that he knew he was fixing to raise Lazarus from the grave, and that Lazarus was resting with the Lord, and he's going to have to bring him back to this earth. You know, that would be sad. Again, I don't know. Once I go, don't bring me back. Okay? Once I'm with the Lord, I don't want to come back to this world. So let's take a look now at what is taking place in our scriptures here. And we find it's about 2 miles now outside of Jerusalem where this little town of Bethany is, and where Jesus has coughed and came and rested with his friends and in the home of Lazarus and his two sisters, Martha and Mary. But all at this time, as we read the scriptures, it's not peaceful on this particular day, is it? In John 11, 1 and 2, it tells us that Lazarus is deathly ill. And in desperation, the sisters send Jesus a message. In verse 3, it says, "Therefore the sisters sent to him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.'" And we realize the response of Jesus is not what we thought it would be in verse 5. It's because we know that he loves him. He says, "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus." And if we consider this, we think, okay, he should get up. If we got a word that somebody we love is deathly sick and they're dying, we usually take off, don't we? We want to be with them. But that's not what Jesus did this time. He delays 2 days. Why did he delay 2 days? Was he too busy? Was he attending to something that was more or greater importance? No. He delayed, and he told us in the scriptures we read, for 2 reasons. In verse 4, he said, "For the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified in it." So it's so God can be glorified. Anytime he did anything, it was to honor God, as we should. Not to honor man, not to build a name for us or for our church or anything, but to honor God. And also, he said in verse 15, it was that you might believe. That you might believe. See, in time of crisis, it's essential that we understand some important facts about time and our perspective. Regarding time, and I'm sure you've heard it, our Lord is never late. He's never late. Now, we think, you know, often he delays his response to our prayers. We know when we pray, if you're a child of God, he loves you, and he told us he does answer and hear our prayers. But sometimes he doesn't answer them the way we think he should, because sometimes he answers, "Yes, we're going to take care of that. We're going to do it. You're going to see a miracle. It'll work right here before you." Sometimes he says, "No. No, you don't need that. You don't want that in your life. You think you want that in your life, but you don't want that in your life. It's better for the glory of God that this is not prayer is not answered." But he answers the prayer. And sometimes he says, like here with Martha and Mary, "Not right now. There's a better time that God will be glorified and honored through it." So he is merely, his watch basically is merely set on a different timetable. It's calibrated to matters of eternal consequence rather than temporal, as we see everything temporal. You see, regarding our perspective, we can adapt to the human or the divine outlet. Look, and it's hard for us to do that. Human perspectives, we focus on the urgent. This needs to happen now. And it blurs our vision, and that we see something as very important. And we concentrate, actually, on our immediate welfare is that we need, rather than the ultimate welfare of what the Lord has. So we look at our temporary good instead of God's eternal glory. Now, divine perspective, if we would try to see it as God sees it, he adds the eternity into the great consequences or the great equation of life. Humans, we plead, "My will be done now. Lord, let's do it." But the divine perspective is we make a request, and when we ask the Lord for something, we say, "But not my will, but thine be done." How's your vision today? How's your sense of divine timing during trials? Do you see only the crisis? Or can you step back and see, I see God's hand working. I see him actually behind me. He's around me. He's before me. He's above me. And he's within this crisis. Even though I don't see how we're going to get out of it, I must trust him. Have you checked your spiritual watch lately? Is it synchronized with eternity, or is it keeping time with you? Now, the reaction of Mary and Martha was very different. As we, you know, by the time Jesus finally arrives, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. And notice their reaction. In verse 20 it says, then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Then Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Now Mary and Martha's reaction, if you'll notice, have a lot of similarities. Because in verse 32 it says, then Mary came to Jesus where Jesus was and saw him. And she fell down at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. They said the same thing. Even though the words were the same, their posture was not. Martha came running to him erect and confronted him. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would have not died. But Mary comes to him and she falls at his feet, prostrate before him, and says, Lord, if you'd been here. You see, Martha was angry, hurt, confused, and crushed, and she engaged Jesus in a theological debate. It says in verse 22, but even now I know that whatever you ask God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? So with this question placed before her, Martha softens. Because she got the grasp of the truth that was presented to her. In John 11, 27, and she said to him, Lord, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. So Martha, actually, we see her, she needed to talk this matter out. She's one of them, okay, a crisis has come in my life. I need to talk this thing. I need to talk it. I need to talk to one who can help me. So she asked a question, and it was pondering, and she was pondering on it, and the Lord talked with her. While Mary needed emotional support and would not even come to him until he called her, she was also angry. She was also hurt and confused and crushed. Why? Was her question. Did you let this happen? Basically, in verse 33, therefore when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews came with her weeping, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and he said, where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. He knew Mary needed that emotional encouragement, that love. They said, see how he loves him. Did you notice the difference? Again, Martha needed to know Jesus was in control. He knows what's taking place. It's taking place for a purpose. Mary needed to know that Jesus cared. And without rebuke or reservation, what did Jesus do? He met both their needs. He was where they were, whether suffering, whether standing, whether falling. Martha was standing, Mary fell before him. Whether in need of intellectual or emotional support, the Lord gave it to him. But did you notice the big thing there is the if. Both of their statements were the same, and they both started, Lord, if. That's a word of blame that is often placed on narrow shoulders, basically. If. You know, if we hadn't have moved here, if we'd stayed there, if I hadn't have married him, if I hadn't have listened to her, if only we had more money, if I'd only taken more time to think things out. What are your ifs today? Will you take time to take him to Jesus, as Martha and Mary did? let him assure you, yes, he's in control, and that he cares about you. Of course, Jesus did raise his Lazarus from the tomb. Let's read that. He waited 44 days because there was a belief in that day that the spirit of the soul hanged around the body for 3 days. So in actuality, they didn't feel that person was dead till after 3 days, really dead. They had to have that. And even I remember in my lifetime, we'd sit around the caskets for 3 days before they buried them. And we'd have the wake. In verse 41 to 43, though, we see after that 3 days is up, when everybody, he is dead. Jesus prays and he shouts, Lazarus, come forth. Of course, it's been said many times, if he hadn't said Lazarus, the whole graveyard would have woke up. But thank the Lord he said Lazarus. And like the scariest of the movies, the mummy, he was wrapped. He gets up and begins to walk. And he says, loose him. But the response to the miracle that they saw, the people saw that day, is mixed. First, we see there is belief. In verse 45, it says that many of the Jews who had come to Mary and had seen the things Jesus did believed on him. But there also was disbelief and deceit. In verse 46, it said, but some of them went away to the Pharisees and told them the things Jesus did. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered to a council and said, what shall we do? For this man works many signs. Now, I'm sure after this, Lazarus was the talk of the town. He was probably the front page of the Bethany Times and the news. And I could see he could have, I don't know why he didn't write a book. Why didn't he write a book from earth to heaven and back? You know, tell us about it. But he became known as the man who had returned from the dead. And that story still touches lives, even today. Two truths we should learn from this trio. First of all, when delay occurs, God had a better time and a better way. And when death occurs, God has a better plan and a better purpose. When we're dealing with crisis, trials, and death, it's never easy, is it? It's never easy. It's not going to be. Yet, we must be prepared for it because we know it's appointed as a man wants to die. But do you know him who has the power over death, hell, and the grave? 1 Corinthians 15 tells you about him. Can you see, as you look around you and you see the things that you're going through, have you taken the time to have a relationship with the Lord and to be in his word? And you can look behind you and say, oh, God's back there. Oh, he's up there too. He's down there. He's up there. He's everywhere. And he's involved in what is taking place. He cares and he is in control. He's in the crisis. I know no one that has actually received Christ as their Lord and Savior and know him in a personal, wonderful way that has ever regretted knowing him, making him Christ, the Lord of their life. And I hope that from the scriptures we've read this morning, the comments we've made, that you also have come to understand that God does love you. He does care, that he's in control, that he desires a personal relationship with you, and that he has, by his grace, done all that he should do so that you can enjoy the joy of being saved by grace. Now, just a moment, I'm going to close with prayer in just a few minutes here. And if the Holy Spirit, not me, but if the Holy Spirit has spoken to you about something in your life, I want you to please take time during that time to settle that matter. Pray to the Lord. And then when you have prayed and you've found the victory in your life, please share it with us so that we can rejoice with you. And if you're walking with the Lord and you have this great relationship and you can see his hand working, we love to hear those victory testimonies too and what God is doing in a person's life. And we love to share more. We have so many testimonies to share. But we're brothers and sisters in Christ, and that's what we need to do. We need to share what God is doing in our life. We need to share our burdens, things we're praying about, because we are brothers and sisters in Christ together. And again, if you don't have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ in your life at this time, again, I'd consider it an honor. If you would, if you're not sure and you want to, I'll be around here for a while. Actually, we're up on the hill as you come in the brick wall in that red RV. It sets up there by itself. That's our home for the next 3 months. And we invite you to come by and see us. We're going to be there all day. We can come back down here if you'd like. First, too, you got my phone number on the cards that I gave you this morning. We'd love to share and pray with you anytime we can, in whatever the matter may be. Rejoice with you or pray with you to know the Lord Jesus Christ, or a matter that may be concerning to you. But let me share these scriptures with you before we pray. Because in Romans 5:12 it says, therefore, just through one man, sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all have sinned. We're all sinners. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. That's why we all must die. But the gift of God is eternal life through the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 5:8 said, but God demonstrated his love toward us that while we were sinners, and a sinner is an enemy of God, Christ died for us. So Christ died for us. How do we receive that eternal life? Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whosoever believes on him will not be put to shame, for whosoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Would you pray with us? Father, we love you and we thank you for this privilege this morning to stand here in this beautiful tabernacle, Lord, you prepared for us, that we could honor you by sharing and preaching your word. We thank you, Lord, for these that have come out here in person to this point here at Three Rivers and helped us be obedient to that which we feel you have called us to do, and that's to share your word again in the campgrounds. And I pray your blessings upon them. And Lord, those that are listening on Facebook right now live, those that will listen later, those that will be on YouTube later, on the website, Lord, ever how you take this out, Lord, we just pray that you will be glorified, you will be honored, and people would know you as their Lord and Savior. They will rejoice in what you're doing, even in the midst of their crisis, Lord, that they will see, yes, Lord, you're in control, and yes, Lord, you care. You care for me where I am right now. In the holy name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. Amen. Amen. Again, thank y'all for helping us be obedient to what we feel God's called us to do at this time. And I want to encourage you, as Adrian Rogers said many times, live today as if Christ died yesterday, he arose this morning, and he's coming back tomorrow. It'll make a difference in your life if you realize he is coming again. Thank you. Amen.